Hello. To tell the story I want to share with you today, I couldn't ask for a better alignment of the sacred and the absurd than to have Lent begin on Valentine's Day and Easter to fall on April Fool's Day. What I would like to do today, though, is to shed light onto the spiritual fruit that has been turned into sugary confection by telling a different story than one that is being told across the globe. The usual story goes something like this. A long, long time ago, a talking serpent convinced a woman to eat from the forbidden tree of knowledge, which led to humankind's expulsion from our earthly paradise. This transgression cast sin on all of their descendants until God decided that he loved us so much he became human by being born to a virgin as Jesus Christ, who would then spread the good news of salvation through belief in his divine origin, and was ultimately put to death by crucifixion, upon which he took on the sins of all humanity and was ultimately resurrected from the dead to return to his rightful place in heaven. And by professing our faith in Jesus Christ as God incarnate, we too can join him in heaven upon our mortal death. Put less charitably, while we may roll our eyes at the first telling and chuckle at the second, my hope today is that you may come away with a new understanding of this strange tale that lets you see the profound beauty of what is actually being said in this ancient story. In Sapiens, Yuval Harari describes a cognitive revolution that occurred 70,000 years ago as being the single most important event in the history of our species. He notes that for the bulk of our ancestors' time on Earth, over 2 million years based on the fossil record and physical evidence of tool usage, early hominids had little more impact on their environment than fireflies or jellyfish. Until about 70,000 years ago, when the 6 known separate human species that existed simultaneously were reduced to a single one. Us. Homo sapiens. Recent findings in South Africa of finely polished awls and spear points made of animal bone suggest the first anatomically modern humans existed on the planet about 70,000 years ago, and other findings of barbed harpoon hooks in the Congo push this date as far back as 90,000 years ago. These tools and artifacts are significant because many of them first needed to be shaped by stone and were then finished by polishing with leather and a mineral agent to become much more than mere tools. They indicate a certain degree of symbolic thinking beyond creating something that was purely functional, which in turn implies an awareness of things beyond the here and now. These people possess the ability to think of the past and the future. The written word first appeared some 5,000 years ago in ancient Sumer, and we know a great deal about the stories of these people, but we will never know the full extent of the stories our distant ancestors told each other. We don't know their legends, their customs, or shared beliefs, but what is certain is that the ability to communicate and tell stories brought us from the scattered bands of isolated humans afraid of the night to who we are today, the absolute masters of this planet. From simple stone tools from 2 million years ago, to something as advanced as the International Space Station, all through our ability to interact with reality in a very unique way. The ancient writers of the Bible tell the story in a slightly different way. For them, the earth was created in 6 days, and humans existed in peace with the animal kingdom until gaining an understanding of good and evil by eating the forbidden fruit of the tree of life in the Garden of Eden. This story of the fall of man is one that most people who have been raised in the West know almost universally. But in telling it, we seem to have lost our ability to perceive the poetic beauty contained within it, and too often take it at face value. Interestingly, though, both these accounts get at the same point in a different way. Either by tool usage or by disobeying God's command, there was something vastly different in us than what could be found in other animals. These acts created a schism that set us on a path separate from the beasts of the field and the birds of the air. Uniquely, we had to toil for our food by wrestling it from the thorns and thistles of the once verdant ground beneath our feet. Simply put, we were on our own. But we had language and the ability to tell stories. Through the use of language, we were able to create rules, laws, and values to unite us in larger numbers than what would have been ever possible without it. And by telling stories, we were able to create new realities beyond the objective one we shared with other species. We can perceive the same rivers, mountains, and trees as any other animal, but we can also place a layer of shared metaphysical reality on top of them that gives rise to a different understanding. Nothing in our biology implies the idea of rights. Nothing in a landscape implies where one nation ends and the next begins. And there is certainly nothing in this, besides our belief in it, that gives it any power over our lives. I say all of this as a way of underscoring how powerful a story can be when enough people believe in it, and how the use of symbolic language, metaphor, and myth can often get to a truth that is somehow more fundamental and expansive than what mere reality could ever hope to contain. So what then can we make of this Jesus story in the 21st century? The objective reality of life for the Jewish people in first century Judea was nothing short of brutal and oppressive, but you don't need to squint too hard to see a certain resemblance to our own. Today, about 1-2% of the total global population controls the vast majority of the world's wealth and resources, leaving the rest with barely enough to survive. A scenario that was all too familiar to the people of antiquity. Then as now, scriptural interpretation often serves as the basis of public policy. Ancient notions of who is clean and unclean were used to decide who could be excluded, where our modern terms of lazy and deviant often serve as the basis of determining who deserves housing, medical care, food, and equal rights under the law. You know, the more things change. In the first century, the Roman Empire and its almost all-powerful military machine commanded a vast territory, covering the entire Mediterranean region and stretching into modern-day Germany to the north, Britain to the west, and Iraq to the east. This period was known as the Pax Romana, or Roman Peace, because there was little more than brushfire skirmishes and no major wars to contend with. But it was a peace at the price of submission. Ahead of the Roman war machine, runners would go into town to alert the local population of the Evangelion, often translated as gospel or good news, which told of the military's impending arrival and the wonderful possibility of their inclusion into the great empire, if they would accept occupation and the small burden of taxes being paid to Rome. Resistance was met with destruction, and crucifixion was a common tactic to instill fear across the land as a warning to quell any would-be acts of insurgency, sedition, or rebellion. Back home in Rome in 44 BCE, Julius Caesar joined a large cast of powerful rulers from across world history when he was formally deified after his assassination, and his adopted son and successor, Augustus, thus became known as the Son of God. Any of this ringing any bells? The Roman government established Herod the Great as the client king of Judea in 40 BCE after conquering Jerusalem 20 years earlier. Essentially a puppet ruler, he was constantly trying to please his Roman overlords with his lavish building projects paid for by extreme taxation on his Jewish subjects. In addition to the brutal Roman occupation and punishing taxation from Herod, the temple system had fallen into corruption, and money collected from worshippers was often spent to maintain the priestly class, and little trickled down to the common person. Suffice it to say, the Jewish people had their backs to the ropes and were desperate for a new story to help them survive this harsh reality. At risk of understatement, the Bible is a rather polarizing subject. Between its covers are 66 books that run the gamut from histories and instruction manuals to breathtakingly beautiful poems, letters, and stories of a people who were struggling to find their place in the world while building an ever more sophisticated understanding of theology. The Gospel of Mark is considered to be the earliest of the four Gospels, and scholars believe it to have been written just prior to the Jewish revolt of 66 CE and the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple some 4 years later. Mark begins his story by noting it was the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, which would have instantly caught the ear of its intended Jewish audience as something altogether different from the familiar gospel of Caesar as Savior, who had brought peace to their world. We often think of Jesus as a carpenter, but the actual word is tekton, which was more accurately translated as technician, a broad class of manual laborers who were only one step removed from being slaves. Thinking he was a carpenter allows us to imagine a certain sense of middle-class respectability, when it's more accurate to think of him as being among the men and women we would find outside any modern building store waiting for a truck to pick them up as day laborers. He was a nobody. Impoverished, uneducated, illiterate. The last person anyone with an eye to social class would ever think to associate with. But he was of and from the people. Through the 16 chapters of Mark, we read of his brief work in spreading a story that was absolutely contrary to the one coming from Rome, Herod, and the temple. His was a story of tending to the needs of the most marginalized of society, the widow, the orphan, the stranger, as well as sharing space with tax collectors and other hated figures. And through the Gospels, he advocated that we needed to turn away from what was familiar and easy and follow his way. His story was the first pan-tribal, multinational, multicultural story of how we need to exist in this world if we are to survive the brutality of that which oppresses us. And it is not by the sword, rather, it is with absolute love and connection. In the book of Matthew, we read of the much misunderstood command that, "You have heard it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles." The first part of this statement speaks less about retribution and vengeance as it does the need to place a limit on what was considered an appropriate response to being wronged. Put another way, the shared belief in the idea of law, as found in the Torah, prevents someone from suffering a worse punishment than the actual offense. But what he says next is truly incredible. "If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also." This is not some prescription on how to get your butt kicked, but a profoundly subversive way to be treated as an equal. According to custom, the left hand was only used for unclean tasks, so the only feasible way to strike someone on their right cheek is by backhanding them with your right hand. Even today, this is a blow that is meant to humiliate and demean a person. Now, if you turn the other cheek so that your left side is now offered as a target, the only realistic blow would be with a fist, but only equals could fight with fists. So, to be slapped on the right cheek is an act perpetrated on a subordinate by someone who was above them. But Jesus asks us to turn to them the other cheek and force the aggressor to treat us as an equal or be humiliated themselves. The command wasn't to submit, but to show the powers that be that their force would no longer be an effective means of control. You can almost hear the victim tell the aggressor, "You may beat me, but you will never beat me." When Jesus tells us that we should hand over our coat when we are being sued for our shirt, he was speaking to the harsh economic reality of the time. People were being crushed by the burden of taxation and were losing their land and possessions to the taxman. But Jesus asks us to give it all away. In Jewish custom, any shame that would have been associated with nudity was not on the part of the person who was naked, but on those that saw someone in their nakedness. So, what Jesus is getting at when he says we should give the plaintiff our coat when being sued for our shirt is a profound indictment on a system that would ask so much of an individual that their last possession, their shirt, is being taken from them. The effect being, "Well, you can have it all, and here I am in my birthday suit, and it is your fault." And when he says we should go the extra mile, he isn't talking about being a real go-getter. He is highlighting the practice of the Roman military to enlist the civilian population as mere pack animals to carry a load. Roman military law dictated that a subject could be called upon to perform this duty for 1 mile. But Jesus is saying, go the extra mile. Do it with a smile on your face. Force the soldier into a position where they may run afoul of their leadership because you haven't put the load down. Your willingness to be meek and serve robs power from an empire who only knew power through strength and violence. In these 3 examples, he was giving the oppressed people of Judea a peaceful way of reclaiming their dignity and a profoundly subversive way in dealing with the system that desperately needed to keep them in submission, all without calling for open revolt, which would certainly lead to destruction. Clearly, he was a dangerous threat to the power balance, and he had to be dealt with. In Luke, we read of the authorities coming to apprehend Jesus and bring him to trial. After being betrayed by Judas's kiss, one of Jesus's cohort drew a sword and sliced off the ear of a slave of a high priest who was part of the posse. If ever there was a call for violence, it would be now, right? To protect the Son of God? But even here, Jesus says, "No more of this," and then touches the man's ear and heals him. While being marched to his death, a crown of thorns is placed on the head of the Son of God, reminiscent of the laurel leaves that adorn the head of the Emperor of Rome. A purple robe is thrown across his ragged shoulders in contrast to the royal vestments that adorned a ruler of a vast empire. And he is taunted in the streets where shouts of acclamation would have been heaped upon Caesar. In all of this, we see a story that ran exactly opposite of the good news of Rome and her military. A story of nonviolence and love, and a call to each of us to decide who we serve, Caesar or peace. It's in the account of Jesus' sham trial and death that we see what may come of those who tell a different story than that of the dominant narrative. In his final act of submission, he gives us the keys to something even more powerful than freedom from oppression. He gives us life itself. Jesus says in the book of John that the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. In the original Aramaic that Jesus would have spoken, to be saved was to be made alive. His goal was to free us from the walking death that so many of us experience in our jobs, relationships, and communities when we are saddled with sin. Now, we may be uneasy with the idea of sin, but it is important to understand sin as simply that which causes separation. Separation from our best selves, from our loved ones, from the concept of the divine. But we've gotten so wrapped up in the idea of sin as something that may keep us from heaven, we have completely missed the point that time and again Jesus stated that he was trying to create the kingdom of heaven here on this earth. On the cross, Jesus takes on the sins of humankind as a way of making them visible, to bring them out into the light so that we can let go of them. The Jesus story helps us see that peace is the only way to truly win against violence, that humility and meekness will defeat arrogance and pride, that we are both loved and worthy of love. To reflect on the beliefs and actions that keep us from living in this life, and how we need to bring out our sins, our separation, and place them on a metaphorical cross in full daylight for everyone to see, so that we can finally be free of them and fully alive here and now. In his final words, Jesus cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Which a literal modern reader may interpret as a moment of doubt, but a devout Jewish person in the first century would have known this as a quote from the first line of the 22nd Psalm, known as a plea to be delivered from relentless enemies, which ends, "To him indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow down all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for him. To him indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow down all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for him. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that he has done it. Alas, it is not a cry of despair, but one of both triumphant surrender and exalted victory over death in this life. In this cry, he is offering us a path to freedom. At the moment of his death, the gospel writers record that the great curtain that divided the middle chamber of the temple from the secret inner chamber where God was thought to have dwelled was ripped in two and fell to the ground, removing that last bit of separation, that between us and the divine. By embodying absolute separation and going peacefully to his own torturous death, a death usually reserved for the worst enemies of the state, the Jesus of this story claims victory over every system of oppression and concretely offers a path to life. A path away from the slow motion everyday death that so many of us experience when we refuse to acknowledge our own points of separation. A path towards beloved community where our swords can forever be transformed into plowshares and where the kingdom of heaven can exist in this place. And 3 days later, the day we are currently observing, when his mother and two other women went to recover his body to anoint it, it was nowhere to be seen. There was nothing left. There was no there, because it has always been right here, inside of us. In closing, I offer the words of Paul Kurtz, the father of secular humanism, who said, "The key to understanding who and what we are is that our futures, as individuals, societies, and cultures, are not fixed or preordained by some hidden hand of God. That what will become of us depends in part on what we choose to become." To which I would add, and what stories we choose to believe. The choice is yours. The story I told you today is one that has been billions of years in the making, stretching back to the first single-celled organisms who garnered a foothold on this wacky planet, to our most distant ancestors who chipped away at stones to create their tools, and to each of us right now. We can choose what story we want to believe about ourselves and what we may become. And as we open each door unto new understanding, I encourage you to forever lead with your heart in peace and wonder as you ask, "What will I find in there?" Thank you, and so it is.